Hello and welcome. It's Thursday, the 25th of November, and my name is Adam Burt. And you can hear my voice because you're watching the Etchplay weekly live show. We're here every Thursday giving you all the latest games industry news, talking about games industry things like marketing, and also we play some games as well and have a good time. I'm joined for the first segment of today's show by Tyre. How's it going, Tyre?
Going very well. Thanks, Adam.
I appreciate your time, and I appreciate your time at home as well, if you're tuned in and watching, whether you're on Twitch or whether you're on YouTube later on. Hello in the chat to Bunyip. Thanks for tuning in. You're a first-time viewer. We appreciate you checking out the show. If you'd like a shout-out, just say hi in the chat, and I will give you one. We've got people coming through now. Hello to Emma. Thanks for tuning in. Anyone else wants one, just say hi. I'm happy to oblige. Here's what's coming on today's show. Our first section today is all about Twitter. We're talking about virality and about how games go viral, what makes them viral. Is it something you can even do? Is it just beyond your wildest dreams? Which Ty's going to join me for shortly. Then we're going to be playing a bit of Hellblade, which is a game that's a couple years old now, but we thought we'd just check it out again because why not? And then later on, Ben Joy will be here to talk about all the latest games industry news with me. Lots of big stories this week to talk about, so stick around for that as well. Hello in the chat to Miles. Thanks for tuning in. Are you ready for our first discussion, Tyre, about Twitter?
I am, and I'm very excited.
Cool. Well, let's talk about Twitter then. I think people at home will probably know what Twitter is, but for those who don't, what's the purpose of Twitter? Like, how does Twitter work?
Twitter is a social media, of course, which is mostly based around kind of discovery and algorithms and the usual kind of bits and bobs that are working in the background to try and get content to users that they're going to enjoy, interact with, sending them to places where they can buy stuff, learn stuff, find out stuff. And it is one of the kind of core platforms that is used within the games industry specifically because it seems that that's just where the games industry has really kind of thrived and grown. And we do see a lot of both game studios and game accounts on Twitter, but also people from the entire ecosystem. So people who work in the media side of things, influencers, PRs, all sorts of different parts seem to live on Twitter. So yeah, That's kind of where we look at quite a lot.
Yeah, I guess Twitter kind of skews a little bit nerdy, which kind of lines up with video games in general, doesn't it? So you've been taking a look at some games which have gone viral on Twitter. So little short videos which you can post onto Twitter. I think you can post up to like 2 minutes, 20 seconds directly natively on Twitter. And obviously you can link off to things like YouTube. But certain games, you know, post clips on Screenshot Saturday or just as like a general tweet during their timeline. And they just seem to take off, right? You just get some tweets just really resonate with people. And I think you're going to talk to us about a few examples, maybe one main example. What have you got for us this
week? Yeah. So the main thing I want to talk about today, because I think it's one of those games marketing things that stood out to me in the last couple of months, is the viral sensation of a game called Choo Choo Charles, which is a first-person horror game created by just one person in a solo studio who I believe, according to reports, is 20 years old. And it basically follows a you as the player trying to build a train to kind of get out of the way of the truly horrific train spider hybrid, which is what the game is kind of named for. So okay, the good old Choo Choo Charles, we can see in the video there, is terrifying. I think when I first saw this video myself, maybe while it was going viral, definitely shared it with everyone I could. So it definitely worked, I think, because it's so unexpected, but it also plays within a lot of memes. And I think we can definitely discuss memes. It's kind of one of the reasons this did as well as it did.
Yeah.
But it definitely, like, having a look through kind of everything that people are saying online about this game, this really came out of nowhere. You know, as far as viral games on Twitter, I think this has been one of the biggest examples of how huge it can go and how big this kind of viral sensation can get you. So some stats I looked up because I was really curious about it were, you know, in a few days it had generated several million views on Twitter, which for an indie game is a huge deal. As of October, it's been retweeted. So this came out on the 1st of October, sorry. Mm-hmm. So in kind of the first couple of weeks, it had been retweeted 13,000 times. It had millions of views on across Twitter, YouTube, and I think TikTok as well. And it generated very impressive 90,000 wishlists in 2 weeks on Steam. And again, these are numbers that are very impressive for an indie, especially an indie that's been developed by a solo creator who has, you know, created some games before, has had a few kind of milder successes. So he has had a little bit of a community around him. But it is very interesting, this case specifically, because it definitely was that everyone was talking about it. As soon as it went viral, you know, you had all the big influencers talking about it. You had all the big press talking about it. It was covered quite extensively by a couple of people in the games marketing sphere. So if you're interested to learn more about the details of exactly how this went viral and kind of some of the reasons for it, I really recommend you check out the Game Discover Co. newsletter by Simon Carlis, and also the How to Market a Game breakdown by Chris Sukowski, because they really go into the numbers. And I wish I could sit here for 15 minutes and just talk about the numbers, but I'm not sure the folks at home would be as excited about that.
I can tell you what the folks at home are saying. I can tell you Bunyip has said absolutely terrifying, and Miles says absolutely horrifying. So two takes there, arriving at the similar conclusion. It's definitely, it just seems to resonate, doesn't it? Like the concept is so strong. Like, you're not going to forget that game. It's just going to be seared directly into your brain. Like, horrifying Thomas the Tank Engine spider hybrid. I've got it forever. I can never drop that. I can never let it go.
That's going to be in your dreams.
Yeah, as if my dreams weren't bad enough. Now I've got Choo Choo Charles to deal with. You're allowed to share numbers on the show, though. Have you got any? Maybe pick out one key number before the end of the segment, and I'll let you share one big one.
Oh gosh, I think, to be honest, for me, it's the 90,000 wish lists in 2 weeks, because I think, you know, obviously we work in marketing, but in my previous life I was working exclusively as a marketing campaign person on indie games. So seeing a number like 90,000 wish lists in 2 weeks is astronomical for you know, the kind of numbers that these games usually get. And it's very interesting because it's a very common question that I would get when I was working primarily, you know, with indie developers and studios. You know, like, how can I make my game go viral? And sorry, Loiner is being very funny in chat.
Don't encourage him. He says, I hope he doesn't choo-choo choose me, which I begrudgingly admit is funny.
It's very funny.
But you're talking about that lightning in a bottle moment, you know, that, yeah, people want to be able to capture mimetic quality. They want to be on the front page of Reddit. They want all these things, but they're quite hard to actually replicate. And I mean, it takes real skill even just to keep up with, like, the zeitgeist, right? Even just keep up with what's trendy and what's on topic, what people are talking about, to actually surf that wave rather than even just being in it and being on top is nigh on impossible or extremely difficult to do, right?
It's extremely difficult. And I think one thing that, you know, I would always tell my clients, and one thing I still say to this day, is there's a lot of components to a game or a video going viral. And a lot of the time, some of them will overlap, but a lot of the time there'll be just something different about that timing or that game that helps it to get to that place. So we can study the games that go viral, we can see what kind of goes on with them, but really you wouldn't be able to follow the exact same path as that game and arrive at the same conclusion. So it's not really something that you could Sorry, they're all
okay,
being punny in
you
this.
should close chat, because I feel like you can't help yourself but look at people making jokes in chat.
I can't. It's fine.
Okay, tell us about another game, because I know that you've put forward that you want to talk about another spider-related game. You want to talk about Web,
yes,
right?
Yes, so going from absolutely terrifying to absolutely adorable, another game that did go fairly viral recently. Not as quite viral as Choo Choo Charles, but... the very adorable Webbed, which I have played and I had the most amazing time with, follows a little spider who is trying to find either her friend or her boyfriend, I can't remember which one, that gets stolen by a bird. And it's basically like a little physics puzzler where you use the spider's web to get around and solve problems and kind of find your way in the adventure. So this also went very viral with a single video on Twitter before it was out, so I think when it was still in development. And I believe all the video that was shown in that first instance was literally just some of the web mechanics.
Yeah.
Some of the early kind of showing kind of how they were working. And people absolutely loved it. You know, there was a lot of people just falling in love with the spider, even though they don't like spiders. I'm one of them. There's people really impressed with kind of the web physics and all the different things that were shown to be possible in this demo video. And it just went on the rounds. It got featured on Wholesome Games and it kind of went from there. So I think very different game, even though it's still spider related, but a very similar kind of process where a single video really elevated this game beyond, I think, what potentially the devs were expecting. And I'm very glad because they made an amazing game that deserves all the love.
Yeah.
I think another one that...
What I was going to say about that one just before we move on is like, that one's interesting mechanically, isn't it? Like, whereas the first one has just got a strong, like, villain, this is really about those... You think it's going to be fun ninja roping your way around with the webs when you see the video, which I think is really cool. Sorry, you wanted to move on. You wanted to move on to another game. You want to talk about Unpacking, right?
Oh, I do, because I played that this weekend, so I'm very excited about Unpacking.
Okay, tell us about Unpacking then.
Another game that did go viral as well, another really simple game, really cute, again, pixelated. I think there is definitely a trend of these games kind of catching attention a lot more recently, and it is really adorable. Again, it went viral with a single video where what you see is basically the game is you get a bunch of boxes, you take stuff out of the boxes, and then you arrange them however you see fit in this kind of apartment. And that's all it was, really. And I think with this one, I definitely bought into it as soon as I saw it. This kind of goes, this video really went along the trend of like almost ASMR based like satisfying videos, you know, those ones where people are literally, you know, they take like a bunch of things and they just arrange them in a certain order. Yeah. On the video, and people love that. I think it really, really kind of played into that. And having played the game, I haven't finished it just yet, I think I'm about halfway through. It definitely comes across, you know, it's no more complicated than exactly what you're seeing in terms of functionality. You know, you're literally just taking stuff out, seeing it somewhere in the room, seeing if it kind of fits, moving things around to make other things fit. It also has an amazing story which just gets told through the mechanics, which is a really interesting way of doing it, but you wouldn't really be able to kind of see that in the trailer. But again, indie game, fairly kind of small at the start, sort of really, really big, kind of viral sensation, and it went on to become a really kind of a gem that everyone was excited for, and it did come out very recently. So
yeah.
Another good one to try out.
The folks at home can actually see this is me playing the game the other day. I would say I'm going to be really dismissive of this game now. The game's wonderful, but for me, I think it is, it's Animal Crossing for people who want Animal Crossing to be even more boring. Like, they just want to do the most basic form of a chore. They don't even want to have to do several chores. They just want one chore and just do that repeatedly. But I think the way that it really tells the story, I think, is interesting, and it's obviously resonating with a lot of people. There's clearly a market for people just to do these kind of relaxing, wholesome is another word that you used as well, wholesome experiences that really deviate from the traditional norms of what we expect games to be. So in that sense, I think it absolutely deserves to be celebrated. You can play it on Game Pass as well. It's It is available to you if you pay that subscription fee. You can check it out on, this is me playing on the Xbox, but I'm guessing you can probably get it on the PC as well.
That's where I played it.
Nice. So what are the kind of takeaways? What should people be thinking? I know you can't guarantee that games are going to go viral, but what are some of the ingredients that can help garner that kind of attention and maybe have some viral sparks, even if you don't get the full viral experience?
So I think having, and these are kind of things that I've seen myself, but also things that I've seen other people talk about quite a lot. You know, with virality, a lot of it is down to luck. You know, that is something you can't really prepare for. It's not really something you can fake. It's not something you can kind of expect to happen. But it isn't all luck. And I think what people who are hoping to kind of try and improve their chances of a viral hit to do is think about the virality as kind of a completely secondary thing, and just thinking about the product, you know, the game. What is it about the game that's going to potentially go viral? You know, if you're making a game that is very similar to other games and functions very similarly to other games, probably isn't as likely to go viral because there's nothing kind of that stands out about it that might kind of catch people's eyes. As you said very rightly, Adam, in Choo Choo Charles, it is the baddie. You know, as soon as you see that, and especially if you are someone who plays a lot of games and you know how much, you know, Thomas the Tank Engine comes up in mods and in kind of the community and the vernacular, you know, as soon as you see it, you're like, I kind of get this.
Yeah,
you know?
I assumed this it was a something. Skyrim mod when I first saw it.
Yep.
If I see a train, especially if it's Thomas the Tank Engine, I assume someone's playing Skyrim.
And I think that's kind of the thing where it's like, it's both a really interesting product, but also it's taking something ridiculous but familiar, which is really interesting. With Webbed, again, it was that really simple, cute little indie game, but with web physics that were, you know, as in-depth as any Spider-Man game. You know, like, really, they've put so much work into getting those right, which I think really resonated with people. With Unpacking, I think there are two kinds of people in the world. There's people like Adam who don't want to do chores and games.
People like me who hate fun.
And then people who love doing chores and games, which is someone like me. So I think for those half of people, this game just kind of came at the right time, and it was like, yeah, we're gonna enjoy that. And kind of, yeah, having that product, but also, like you say, a lot of it is about the hard work of staying on top of what's happening. You know, that timing and that right place and right time to be at to go viral, you need to be really aware of exactly what is going on in the wider community. So if you see an opportunity, you can kind of increase your chances by doing something different or doing something exciting or special. And I think in this case, I think all of those games had some of those elements at them. And, you know, the main thing is to remember is your game can still succeed without going viral. You know, it's not a prerequisite to marketing. It can be a really nice boost, but it can be a lot harder work to try and chase after that virality and get nothing back than just doing everyday run-the-mill marketing where you're just building your awareness kind of more gradually. And you could end up at the same level.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you're definitely right about that timing aspect. It's almost like, I feel like wholesome games really had a real moment in 2020, and still now they're having that moment because the world generally outside was so horrible. People were just like, you know what I'm really in the mood for? Something completely comforting, something that feels like a blanket, something that's just joyous. And spotting those sorts of opportunities, those trends in mood, and being like, you know what, people right now really need or really want a game just like mine. That's the time to potentially strike. And I guess the golden thing to think about is, you know, you look at these people who've gone viral and you think, oh, how lucky they are, and they are lucky, but how many days does it take to become an overnight success? These people have put in the work. They've been regularly promoting their games in other ways throughout. It's not like they, you know, put one post up and it just caught fire straight away. Typically, they will have built a little community, or they will have established themselves or posted other days and it's not really worked out. So, yeah, lots of food for thought there. And I appreciate your time, Tyre. And thanks for your insight, as ever.
No problem at all. It's always fun to talk about spider trains.
Yeah.
I'll find a way to bring it up again.
We're going to leave the Spider-Verse now. And we're going to throw to our pre-recorded segment, which this week is me and Dan Thomas talking about Hellblade. This is about 8 minutes long, and when we come back, stick around, because Ben Joy will be here talking about all the latest game industry news. See you in a few minutes.
Bye.
Hello, and welcome. It's Etch Play Video Time with me, Adam Burt, and I'm joined by Dan Thomas.
Hello.
We're checking out Hellblade Senua's Sacrifice. This is on the Xbox Series X here. And Dan, you've played this, so you can be a bit of our guide to the world of Hellblade. We are playing as someone called Senua, I'm assuming, and walking around.
I think it's pronounced Senua, but I think it varies, I don't know, regionally or from character to character.
Okay, my apologies to any Senuas watching at home. I've mispronounced your name.
I may have got that completely wrong, but I'm pretty sure it's a few years ago that I played it. But I'm pretty sure in the game that's how they refer to her. But, okay. Yeah.
It shows how much attention I've been paying.
Well, I've just completely made it up and discredited myself.
So you can probably hear there's like whispering going on. That's not us. That's not somebody behind me or something. That's actually in the game. And the game in general is like an interesting kind of metaphor story about like psychosis and mental health in some pretty, I guess, dark ways. For the main character. How much have you played of this, Dan? Have you played through this?
Yes, we played through it all, finished it. And, it's a really interesting journey you go on. As you say, kind of, I've taken the option to, I guess it's representation of somebody experiencing psychosis and, I guess, enabling and a window into that world. But coupled with a more fantastical kind of setting.
Yeah, it's what is this world? It's like, is Vikings or?
I think you're some sort of Celtic warrior type person.
If you want to bet, I'm going to fall off this beam. But you know that
death is near. Yeah, there you go.
Okay, that's how not to play the game. Now let's see how to do it correctly.
Good demonstration there.
You're welcome. I did that for you at home.
I can imagine a lot of people like, am I supposed to fall off this narrow beam?
Yeah, this could be the way forward. You never know. I was going to fall off again then. But the game has these sorts of, like a lot of traversal. There's a little bit of kind of pattern matching where you've got to like find items in the world or places in the world that match certain patterns, that match certain symbols and runes. There is some combat as well, isn't there?
Yeah. It's quite it's kind of a blend of narrative heavy, some might say a little bit on railsy kind of exploration.
Yeah.
But it's mostly, I guess it's kind of providing that journey cast her down into Helheim, gave her power over those and some really strong kind of environmental and voice acting and just quite an immersive story really.
Yeah, this is on Game Pass, that's the way I played it, and they're making a second one, right?
Yes, the folks at Ninja Theory, they got after this, I think they became a first party Microsoft studio. And yeah, working on the sequel. Which I'm looking forward to.
Yeah. Is it a long game? I get the impression it's maybe not that long.
It's not huge, no, because it's Yeah, because it is a linear story, really.
Mm. It's more of an experience.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, there's ample content there.
Yeah, I mean, I like that stuff anyway.
Digestible.
Yeah.
Just having a quick look at what date this was released. It's been around a few years now, hasn't it? 2017.
Yes. So they recently released an Xbox Series X update for it that like makes it prettier.
And it is, isn't it? It's stunning.
A little while.
I can remember the original release was also very impressive. So.
Yeah. Really good motion capture work. They've obviously done a lot of extensive facial animation and, well, full body capture as well, it looks like.
Remember, this was released in the early stages of kind of photo mode becoming a popular thing, and there were some really, really nice photos and screenshots floating around.
Mm. It's a bit creepy.
It's very chilling.
Yeah. She's having a really bad day.
Yeah. I do appreciate these kind of cinematic experiences. You can really see strong acting, like through the mocap and through the voice acting, really comes through on this little thing.
Yeah. Okay, here's a guy. Let's stab him. Just getting my dodges in. Yeah, saw that. Boom.
Quite the badass, isn't she?
Yeah, she's pretty handy with that sword.
Not fazed by a bit of blood splatter.
How did you find the combat in this?
I'm trying to remember if we manipulated the difficulty or not.
That's me.
It's quite a common thing now is just dial back the difficulty, because I'm all about the, you know, the story and experiencing all of the game. And
oh man, that's not what you want.
Really is very
it's intense, isn't it?
Intense, yeah, that's a good word.
It's like, you know, you're watching a TV show and you're just like, maybe you're like, oh, this will be fun, let's put this TV show on, and then like an hour later you just sat there, you like haven't even touched your snacks, you're just like, well,
wow,
that was
something.
That was a ride.
I think that is great though, like that is where we're at with games, is they can actually, you know, give you those emotive experiences.
Mm. Well, yeah, this is available on Game Pass. If you want to check it out, you can. And the sequel is hopefully coming soon, although we don't actually have a date, I believe. And we're going to throw back to the studio. See you again on a future Edge Play video. Take care.
Bye. Until there is nothing left of her.
Hello and welcome back. You are watching the Edge Play weekly live show, your one-stop shop on Twitch for all the latest games industry news and views and gameplay clips, and sometimes we eat cake. Honestly, it's a weird channel. Just follow and subscribe and you'll get used to it. I'm joined now for the final segment of the show by Ben Joy. How's it going, Ben?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you, Adam. How are you?
I'm not bad. Have you been playing any games this week?
I don't think I have, actually.
Oh. Cool, okay.
I was
you
gonna...
You played Halo with me. You have played games this week.
I played that. I played Halo with you.
We both played.
I repressed it because it didn't go very well.
Yeah, Ben enjoys. He doesn't want to talk about it. He doesn't want to talk about his kill death ratio in Halo Infinite at any point.
I had a good run in one of the games when I was camped out the side, capped the flag, was taking a lot of people out.
Yeah.
I mean, for my standard.
Yeah, it's definitely you're in a league of your own. Let's put it that way and leave it at that. Should we talk about the latest games industry news?
Yeah, why not? That's what we're here for, right?
Sure. Our first story is all about Cloud Imperium Games, and specifically the title Star Citizen, which you might remember we've talked about recently. So the game's been in alpha for 9 years. It's been crowdfunded the entire way. And they now have passed a pretty huge milestone, which is surprising to me, but apparently it's been doing well all this time. They've raised over $400 million, now totaling over 3.3 million backers. We recently spoke on the show about their new plans to open a 1,000-person office here in the UK, up in Manchester. But it's a real incredible achievement, and I guess kind of explains why they're able to invest on so much property, because they've got the money. It's an interesting state of affairs, because I mean, the game is, depending on who you ask, either an incredible example of what crowdfunding can do, or annoying in the sense that the game has been around development for 9 years and still isn't out, and some people are saying, is it ever going to be out, you know, out of alpha, or will it always just be this kind of early access beta title? But either way, impressive numbers, and huge congratulations to the guys at CIG. I mean, this is quite a thing to pull off, right? This is the biggest success story in crowdfunding history. What do you make of it, Ben?
Yeah, I mean that game's got to come out, right? You can't take that amount of money and be like, thanks, guys. See you later.
You can play it. You can play the alpha. So it's in some ways.
Yeah, but I mean, it's got to come out. It's got to come out fully out of alpha. But I mean, absolutely incredible. I mean, I think it's important. We're joking around. It's important that it comes out past an alpha or a beta release, because otherwise it's like, it puts a dampener on what they've done. Like, you want people to be encouraged by this and do it. And if people see that you can raise all this money without having to do, like, actually release the game in full, it won't necessarily detract people from trying to do Kickstarter campaigns. It will detract from people backing them. And then you won't see this. I don't think you'll ever see this kind of success again with these kind of numbers. But you won't see games that need it to succeed because people will just become skeptical of it. But I mean, yeah. Outstanding achievement, like it's mind-boggling, really, and it makes opening a 1,000-person studio in Manchester seem like, no big deal. Mm. Why wouldn't we? Don't change.
It's an interesting reflection on a trend in the industry in general towards early access, which we know has been huge for Steam since they started doing early access, but also the relationship that developers have with gamers and subscription models. You know, things like, look at something like Grounded. On Game Pass, for example, it's on Game Pass, so they feel justified in being like, you can play it now, but it's not done, and it might not be done for a very long time. So it's interesting to see the ways in which different companies are approaching that and how they might make it a success. Our next story, though, is about mergers and acquisitions. Still talking big business, talking about Epic Games, and specifically the fact that Epic Games have acquired Harmonix. So Harmonix, if you don't know who they are, they're pretty famous, but they're known for the Rock Band series and for Dance Central, and they've put out a statement relating to this sale saying that DLC plans for Rock Band 4 and the DJing simulator Fuser are unaffected by the sale. Obviously, you know who Epic Games are. They're one of the biggest companies in the world, especially in games. But the joint statement suggests that the Harmonix will develop musical journeys and gameplay for Fortnite, in addition to making musical projects in the so-called metaverse, and the word so-called myself. Dancing has always been a surprisingly large part of Fortnite culture, and this seems very much like an acquisition focused around building out more music and dancing-focused activity for Fortnite, which, as well as being one of the biggest games of all time, has also become home to a number of metaverse-esque concepts, such as experiences and virtual concerts and all those sorts of things. So it seems to make business sense. Some people will be upset that there might not be a new Rock Band or might not be a new dance game from them, but they're going to be part of something potentially very big for Epic. What do you make of this, Ben?
Yeah, I'm one of the people who would rather see more Rock Band games come out than more then work on the Fortnite stuff, which, just because I like the Rock Band games, I think they're a lot of fun. So it would be a shame if that kind of dies a death now. They move on and nobody else picks that up, because they are good games, they're fun games to play. But in terms of like taking my personal, like, I prefer Rock Band over Fortnite. Like, it's very exciting. Like, the stuff, even if you're not into Fortnite, like, there's so many amazing things that are happening in that area and in that game. I'm with you kind of on the so-called metaverse. I'm a bit of a skeptic on that, even though we spoke about it before. Like, it's just going to be interesting how it plays out. But anything that creates bigger and better experiences in the gaming world, I'm all for. Especially musically, I'm a big music fan. So seeing what you can do with music in games excites me. Yeah, it'd be fun to see what they do. And, you know, they're a team with a very good track record, which is obviously why Epic wanted to get hold of them, and it's Epic, so of course they can if they want to. So yeah, best of luck to them, and it'd be interesting to see what happens next.
Cool. Well, our next news story is all about another huge game. This is about League of Legends. So you might have seen this recently. Arcane is a Netflix animated series which is set in the League of Legends universe, and it was announced this week that it's been renewed for a second season. We saw really high viewing figures for this. So, I mean, Riot has produced several videos, like music videos and animated shorts in the past. This is their first full-length series. It was Netflix's number 2 most watched English language TV series globally during the week of November 8th, November 14th, last week, with 13.17 million hours being watched. Huge congratulations to everyone involved in the series, and also, wow, I mean, video games are definitely a big business factor on Netflix now. It seems like it's kind of the start of something here. Like, we've had a lot of video game adaptions in film in the past, and now in this kind of age of television and streaming, there's set to be a slew of TV adaptions in the near future in high profile games as well. So we're talking about Last of Us series is in the works at HBO. Halo is coming to Paramount Plus next year, and a Fallout series is in development at Amazon. This week it was also reported that Amazon is exploring doing a TV series based around Mass Effect. So lots of TV shows, or lots of video games rather, are exploring this avenue, partnering with TV companies and streaming to create extended experiences. I know, Ben, this is something that's interesting to you. You love it when people do animated shorts, animated series. What do you make of this? This is excellent, right?
It is excellent, because, and you touch on there, we're all about extended experiences here at Edge Play. We love them, love seeing them. So when people are doing innovative and new things, it's always great to see it. And what's so great about these is that it attracts so many more people to your game. Like, you know, not any game can do this. Like, you know, an indie game isn't going to spin up a TV series and it be a hit. Like, you need to have some kind of weight behind you. But it shows what's possible and what's doable and what it can do to those audiences. I mean, the numbers you said about the viewing figures for the League of Legends series, like, there'll be large chunks of that probably don't play the game and then might go and play the game now that they, like, oh, it's part of this game world, I'll go check out the game. So it's an interesting shift, as you say, into TV rather than film, because you would typically always think film, but yeah, like things like The Witcher and all the ones that you reeled off, you know, TV series coming from games. I know The Witcher's a book as well, so you could argue that it's come from the book. But yeah, it's an interesting way of consuming gaming content, even though it's not really gaming content. It's giving people a chance to enjoy those worlds without having to pick up the controller. And you know me, when you asked me at the beginning, have I been playing games? No, it's because I've been watching. It's because I've been watching TV shows all week, because it's less effort.
He's been watching Mrs. Brown's Boys controller. Instead.
So, you know, if you can enjoy the gaming content that you like without gaming, that's, you've really tickled yourself there. It's just great to be able to have those experiences with gaming content, with gaming worlds, outside of actually gaming yourself. So I'm all for it. It's great to see, and I'm sure we'll see more and more as we progress over the years. It's definitely where the trend seems to be going.
Yeah, And the last news story this week is about working practices and just about what's going on in the industry, taking the pulse of how people are feeling. Obviously, it's been a pretty rough couple of years from a working practices point of view, the pandemic and having to uproot people's ways of working and adapt to remote working and all those things, which in some ways has been very positive and other ways has been quite difficult for companies and for staff. So this week, the news is that the recruitment agency called Amiquis have done a survey and they found that 82% of professionals in the gaming industry say that their productivity has been the same or increased while working from home, which is good news. This was across the entirety of Europe. They did a survey of over 400 games industry staffers on how the lockdown of COVID-19 in various countries had changed their opinions on work conditions and their careers looking ahead. They gave some answers and some reasons for why they are now starting to prefer working from home. Saving money was the top one at 83%, better work-life balance at 73%, and spending more time with family at 61%. Interesting things there, considering that, you know, the game industry famously has a real issue with crunch and burnout and putting in too much time. So it's really interesting that people would be taking this opportunity to claim back some of that work-life balance and their family time and things like that. The last thing that the survey reported is that 79% of respondents are considering a career move to achieve their ideal working conditions. So I guess this is going to be a factor over the next 12 to 18 months. Companies who are hesitant to support remote working might find that some staff are no longer happy with that arrangement, or, you know, it's going to be an interesting time for hiring and recruitment. No matter where you're based, really, just in terms of how you're going to tackle this, what your stance is going to be, and why. What do you reckon, Ben? What do you make of this story?
I think those two stats are really very, very interesting. The 82% feel that they're more productive, or at least as productive, but 79% want to move to get a better working environment for them. So that tells you that the industry hasn't quite caught itself up yet. Really, that people are still being as productive. Still getting a lot of work done, if not more, but almost the same number of people feel like they're going to move because their working pattern isn't right for them. And I can only assume that's probably because as the world is opening up, people are wanting you to go back into the office. Now, offices have their place. I would never say fully like everyone should get rid of their office. Offices can be a great place, but I mean, for me personally, I like working from home. I feel like I'm more productive. But I like having somewhere to go for the social aspect and seeing people. Like, it feels like that's a novelty. But yeah, it's something the industry is going to need to watch. And the people who will really succeed in the coming years, I think, are those that can adapt to what employees want. Because I feel like employees now are probably in the strongest position they've ever been in with making these kind of cases for how they want to work. Like, we know in the games industry, talent is at an absolute premium. Every single studio is hiring. Everyone's hiring for senior talent. Everybody needs more people. And if you're not offering the flexibility that the top talent wants, they'll go somewhere that will. And those are the studios that will kick on because they're getting hold of the best talent. So, you know, if you're an employee, you now have the power to say, this is the way I want to work. If you want me, like, This is what I want. And if companies really want them and need them, they're gonna have to adapt. Like, there was no choice in the last 2 years. You had to work from home. Really, we didn't have an excuse. And now we've proved it works. 82% of people have proved it works, and it works well. So the studios are gonna have to get on board if they want to retain that talent. So
yeah, definitely food for thought. And yeah, interesting to think about, especially if you're planning your 2022 recruitment plans. That's our show. Thanks for tuning in. Really appreciate it. Appreciate you, whether you're watching us live on Twitch and posting puns in the chat, or whether you're watching us on YouTube on catch up. Make sure that you like and subscribe on YouTube. And if you're on Twitch, you can follow us here so you get notified whenever we go live. If you like the show, if you like our opinions, if you like news about the world of games, make sure you check out etchuk.com/play tomorrow, because every Friday we do a text roundup where we collate some of the bigger stories in games and talk about our opinions on them in blog form, which is always a lot of fun. So make sure you don't miss that. As for the show itself, this will be back next week. We're actually away on a company retreat next week, so the show will probably be pre-recorded, but there will be a show in some form. We just haven't figured out exactly how it's going to work yet. So stick around for that. Be back, rather, next week at 4 p.m. We will see you then. Take care.
Hi.